She's driven by the power. She's driven to get the power. That is the driving force in her life.
She does not answer questions straight out.
She is the expert of not saying what she believes. She will run on attacking Republicans and being the first woman president. And oh, isn't that amazing? Ooh, it's a woman. She can walk and talk.
The thought here is it's all politics. Parcel out favors to individual groups, whether it's unions here or the farm bloc there.
But she is steeped in controversy, steeped in sleaze. That's why they don't want us to look at her record.
I would recommend that Hillary Clinton appreciate that she's not going to be, by any means, the candidate of American women. American women have diverse views on politics, just like men.
At the core of almost every one of the investigations we did for 8 years, where there were problems, and I mean major problems, with the Clinton administration, she was at the core of them.
It's part of the Clinton method, which is say what you need to say at any given moment and rely on the lack of memory of the American public and the support of the mainstream media to support that lack of memory.
Well, the 20-year plan really is that the Clintons share power. One would be president 8 years, and one would be president another 8 years over a span of 20 years with a little Republican in between, perhaps.
So in essence, what happened is that Bill and Hillary, in their mid-20s, before they ever took their marital vows, they took their political vow.
You know, a lot of people ask me, do we have to go through all these old Clinton scandals again? Well, I have good news for you. You don't, because you can look at the new ones, because Hillary Clinton scandals are a gift that keeps on giving.
Ruthless, vindictive,
mendacious, venal, sneaky,
ideological, intolerant.
Liar is a good one.
Scares the hell out of me.
Looks good in a pantsuit.
Today that I'm forming a presidential exploratory committee. I'm not just starting a campaign, though. I'm beginning a conversation with you, with America. So let's talk. Let's chat. Let's start a dialogue about your ideas and mine. And while I can't visit everyone's living room, I can try. So let the conversation begin. I have a feeling it's going to be very interesting.
The challenge for Hillary Clinton on the campaign trail is she has to pretend to be something she's not. She's far more liberal than she's going to want to let on. That means you have to be very controlled. You can't be too spontaneous. You're pretending to be something. And I think that's going to be a potential problem for her on a couple of grounds. It's inauthentic, and people spot that.
I am sick and tired of people who say that if you debate and you disagree with this administration, somehow you're not patriotic, and we should stand up and say we are Americans and we have a right to debate and disagree with any administration.
She's a person who's struggling herself with figuring out who she is, or more importantly, how she wants to present herself to the American public, because her own advisors told us her sort of authenticity and who she is issue one, issue two, and issue three for her.
I don't feel no ways tired. I come too far from where I started from.
She's continually trying to redefine herself and figure out who she is and project an authenticity to voters who are, of course, wondering, who is the real Hillary?
Hillary Rodham Clinton. Could she become the first female president in the history of the United States? Her name is known by nearly every American, but who she really is remains largely a mystery. Hillary Clinton points to her time in the White House as a large part of her qualification for the job as president. But most of the news media has conveniently forgotten that her time as First Lady was mired in controversy.
The core of the controversy is how truthful Mrs. Clinton has been in answering questions, sometimes under oath, about Whitewater and other matters.
She was the first lady to come under criminal investigation, In both Little Rock and Washington, D.C., she was plagued by numerous scandals.
Senator Clinton has extraordinary ability to obfuscate, refuse to answer questions, avoid confrontations, and up until now has been given a pass on it.
A story in the New York Times talking about why Senator Clinton voted this way, because I think some people were surprised by it. And her advisor said that she voted yes because she was moving from primary mode to general election mode. Primary mode versus general election mode? How about tell the truth mode? How about we say the same thing in the primary that we say in the general election?
We know that Hillary's an insecure person. Secure people don't lie. They don't lie inveterately the way she does.
What drives Hillary now is power. She very much is interested in gaining power. She considers herself to be a special person. She has a lot of arrogance, a spirit of superiority about her, and this is the driving force in her life, is to gain and acquire and maintain power. And her husband got to the top, and see, she saw it, she felt it, and she wants there herself.
Over the past 16 years, Hillary Clinton has undoubtedly become one of the most divisive figures in America. How this makes her suited to unite the country as the next president is troubling to many.
And recall Hillary speaking at a black church on Martin Luther King Day. What a coincidence.
When you look at the way the House of Representatives has been run, it has been run like a plantation, and you know what I'm talking about.
And you know what I'm talking about, girlfriend. That's how she's going to get to power? By accusing the Republicans of running a plantation at a black church on Martin Luther King Day. That's it? Okay.
After announcing her bid for the presidency, fellow Democrats, including former Clinton confidant and Hollywood mogul David Geffen, publicly questioned Hillary's integrity and truthfulness. Such breaks within the Clinton inner circle beg the question, what is the truth about Hillary Rodham Clinton?
It's a recklessness that's born of arrogance that goes back to her 1960s roots in their narcissism. They believe they are a rule unto themselves. I mean, every time Hillary's been caught in a scandal, she really did it. No one made it up.
She's deceitful. She'll make up any story, lie about anything, as long as it serves her purpose of the moment. And the American people are going to catch on to it.
So who is the real Hillary Clinton? Is she a brilliant trailblazer poised to make history as the first female president? Or is she ruthless, cunning, dishonest, willing to do anything for power?
Because of your position or your husband's, might have given you some kind of unfavorable or, you know, a favored advantage?
There isn't any evidence that anybody gave me any favorable treatment.
Yes? Yes, one question I'd like a follow-up to. First one has to do with Susan McDougall. She said that she brought the documents of Whitewater over to you at the governor's mansion. Did you receive all the documents? And if so, what became of them?
Every document that we have obtained has been turned over to the special counsel, no matter where it came from.
Mrs. Clinton, can you tell us what you know about stories about shredding of Whitewater documents down in Arkansas?
Nothing.
At the gubernatorial mansion?
Oh, that didn't happen, and I know nothing about any other such stories.
You know nothing about documents relating to Whitewater ever shredded anywhere that you know about or authorized or didn't authorize?
Absolutely not.
When you look at all the skullduggery in the Clinton administration, all roads lead back to Hillary.
It also tells us something about the character of the American media. I mean, they carry these people. A Republican with those numbers of character flaws, with that sort of behavioral problem and psychopathic psychology, could not run or be elected to dog catcher if it were a Republican.
The politics of personal destruction was a phrase popularized by the Clintons in the 90s to describe the attacks by what Hillary called the vast right-wing conspiracy. But is she actually more familiar with practicing that fine art than being its victim.
They have been the masters of the politics of personal destruction, and then they use the well-known trick of accusing your opponents of your own malfeasance. So they accuse conservatives of speaking honestly about the ethical shortcomings of the Clintons, while they in fact speak dishonestly about the integrity of their opponents. And that has been a bellwether, and it has done destruction to people who they've encountered.
Even people in the Democratic Party will acknowledge the Clintons are particularly ruthless and particularly aggressive when it comes to campaigns. They war room. This is a military metaphor for the campaign the Clintons invented regarding instant responses, that no matter what the validity of a charge, you don't explain the charge, you don't apologize for the charge, you don't admit any error, you automatically attack the integrity or the motivations of the other side.
There are any number of things in the Clintons' political history that is worth recalling before you go in to vote for, potentially, for a Clinton, in this case, a Hillary Clinton. And it's a small example, but a telling one. When they turned on the travel office, where you had career civil servants doing a great job providing the travel service for the president and his staff, and they wanted to get a lackey friend in, they could have fired the guy in charge, but they accused him of a crime. They tried to ruin his life in order to be able to get him out and get their lackeys in.
When the Clintons moved to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue in 1993, White House veteran Billy Dale was the director of the travel office. Dale had faithfully served seven previous presidents, starting with John F. Kennedy in 1961. But Dale, who had actually voted for Clinton for president, would soon discover that business under the Clintons would not be business as usual.
We knew that we were in for a rougher transition because we had heard stories from Secret Service agents who had gone to Little Rock for a two-week stay down there. And the stories that some of the agents would come back and tell us, that we just knew that it was going to be different. We didn't realize how different it was going to be. The new administration is free to fire anybody that they want to, but traditionally that does not happen.
On the day of Clinton's inauguration, Wednesday, January 20th, 1993, Billy Dale got a call from an unknown woman indicating that Catherine Cornelius, the 24-year-old third cousin of President Clinton, would soon be working in the travel office.
When I got to know who Catherine Cornelius was, she went to work in David Watkins' office answering phones, but she never let up in her demands to take over the travel office. In the meantime, I get a telephone call from a gentleman in Ohio, and he wants to know how he can get in on some of the White House charter business. And I said, that's what I do. I arrange the charters. And he said, I know, but he says, we can make some money here. If I had made arrangements with that gentleman, I speculate that things would have been very different than as they turned out.
That call was from Darnell Martins, a partner of Clinton's close friends and Hollywood producers, Harry and Linda Bloodworth Thomason, in a travel agency called TRM. When Congress investigated, they learned Harry Thomason had multiple conversations with First Lady Hillary Clinton about taking over the White House charters.
At that time, I didn't even know who Harry Thomason was, but we have since learned that Catherine was reporting to him and he was reporting to the First Lady, Hillary Clinton.
As Dale says, every new president has the right to hire new travel office staff, even though no president had done so for over 30 years. But not only was Billy Dale fired, along with six other travel office staff members, he was also locked out of his office. But that was only the beginning.
And I got accused of embezzling $14,000 that I couldn't account for because the logs were missing. At the same time, D.D. Myers is in the press room briefing the White House press corps, telling them that we were being fired for criminal misconduct and the FBI was being called in to conduct a criminal investigation.
I think that they wanted to make it look like they were doing it because there was corruption over there so nobody would criticize them, because the media liked Billy Dale and the people there.
Gary Aldrich was an FBI agent for 26 years, the last five as an agent responsible for background checks on White House staff.
Recall that the FBI had conducted investigations of all of these men
and had determined that they were qualified to work in the White House and that they were honest individuals. I conducted some of those investigations. Billy Dale was humiliated and was accused of serious wrongdoing to the degree that they conduct a federal grand jury investigation and an indictment of him.
I had dedicated 32 years of my life to this job and served faithfully to Democrats and Republicans alike.
The experience was a major event in my career because it taught me that powerful politicians can misuse law enforcement authority almost whimsically. And because it was the First Lady ordering the investigation, well then, charges have to be found. That scared me. That was different from my experience in the FBI of 26 years. I thought, if we have reached the level where a politician can get irritated with somebody and cause them to maybe end up in federal prison, we've got a serious problem.
The White House travel office affair became known as Travelgate. When Dale's legal bills to defend himself were estimated to run as much as $750,000, he considered a plea deal, a fine of $69,000, and a brief jail sentence.
Blanche and I had been married for 38 years at that time. I decided that I would have to sell my home. Could I ask her to give up everything that we had worked for?
The plea bargain seemed just that, a bargain in order to save himself and his family from the unending ordeal. But when Dale was informed he would not be able to proclaim his innocence, he realized he couldn't bargain with the truth.
In the meantime, during this year, I got a notice from the IRS that I was being audited.
For the next 30 months, Dale was investigated. His son and daughter were also subpoenaed.
I remember Vicky, our oldest daughter, telling her mother that if I was found guilty, and maybe we better start over. I remember during my trial, Vicky, my oldest daughter, telling her mother that if I was found guilty and had to go to jail for something that I did not do, that she didn't know if she could live in this country any longer, when the government would be responsible for doing something like that to her father.
When the case went to trial in the fall of 1995, a procession of White House journalists volunteered to serve as character witnesses for Dale, including Britt Hume and Sam Donaldson.
The press at the time, I think, ought to remind people that I testified at Billy Dale's trial as a character witness for him.
The jury needed less than 2 hours to reach a verdict.
And the jury came in and they found me not guilty on all counts. I laid my head down on the desk in front of me and cried.
Ultimately, the Office of the Independent Counsel's final report on the travel office firings found that Mrs. Clinton's sworn testimony was factually inaccurate.
Hillary Clinton was more powerful as a first lady than any first lady that had been in the White House that I knew of. Until I have learned that she was involved with it more than Bill was. Bill just wiped his hands of it and just would let her handle it.
That's an example of the cynicism and the ruthlessness of the Clintons. And at the time, I think a lot of people thought that Hillary had at least as much to do with that as Bill did.
What she did to the travel office, I mean, in a way, that is the most illustrative scandal because it was such an Evita Perón act of maliciousness toward these ordinary people. This guy running the travel office all these years, I'm getting them out, getting my rich Hollywood friends in. It's not even the most illegal thing they did, but it is the most contemptible thing they did.
Billy Dale wasn't the only victim of what some would allege to be Hillary Clinton's brutal and corrupt political machine.
I would say the most important thing I would study is her conduct as First Lady, not as Senator. And her lack of sensitivity to civil liberties, of privacy, using the Internal Revenue Service, her hostility to opponents, her hardness, her meanness. The Clinton administration, almost from its first day, started using the IRS as a threat.
I know a lot of tax lawyers, and they said the odds of someone like Paula Jones, with her income, being audited by the IRS is like being struck by lightning twice.
Others would claim that using the IRS to harass political enemies was a Clinton White House specialty, one reminiscent of the strong arm of Richard Nixon.
They're both very smart, very politically ruthless, very hardworking, great work habits. Some of them not complimentary, very cynical, willing to do things that are beyond the pale of proper conduct.
Proper conduct would not include using private investigators to intimidate. Those allegations come from several women involved with Bill Clinton, including Jennifer Flowers, Elizabeth Ward Grayson, Paula Jones, and Kathleen Willey.
The scare tactics, you know, being followed, being audited by the IRS, their homes broken into. I mean, where does it end?
Clinton supporter and campaign worker Kathleen Willey was a White House volunteer who alleges that President Clinton sexually assaulted her during a meeting in the private study off the Oval Office in November of 1993.
I kept thinking to myself, what in the hell is he doing? That's what I kept thinking. And which sounds silly at the time, but I was getting embarrassed for him. If that does, that's just, you know, this is just not proper. You have to remember, this was at the time when